Shannon and I are so happy to be with you again, and our subject of discussion is the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Is Jesus really coming back, and when he is coming back, where is he going to come back to? Perhaps you may not have considered this area, but it's a very, very important area, mm-hmm. the time and the season that we're living in.
Yes.
And you've been doing a research on earthquakes, and the
yes.
you mentioned how the number of earthquakes have increased exponentially,
dramatically. Yes, and since the 1970s, and even more so since the 1990s onwards.
Since the 1990s, the number of earthquakes have increased exponentially, and of course we noticed the tsunami.
Which really was an earthquake.
Underground earthquake and the devastation. I think what's really prompted me to bring this subject at this time is what's been happening with the bees. They think, wow, what have bees got to do with the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ? Mm. But I saw on the television that the bees in this country are disappearing.
And not just this country, actually.
Is it all over? Okay. Mm. And the bees are very instrumental in the area of food.
Yeah. Pollination. They pollinate the crops.
The fruits.
And about a third of our diet.
Okay. A third of our diet is pollinated by the bees.
Yes.
So how does that tie in? Well, the Bible talks about famines.
Yes.
Now, of course, we've seen famines in India and Africa.
The developing world, yes.
Yeah. But we've never seen famine in the West.
Well, since the Industrial Revolution.
There was the Great Irish...
But there's been many famines in the past.
In Ireland and... But in modern day, we have not seen... And so to see a famine in the West would be quite something. Yeah. And so the bees... And so I began to think, goodness gracious, what's going on here? Bees are disappearing. Are we going to have the big famines? And of course, the earthquakes now, the floods this week
in Pakistan,
you know, and then we had the Haiti earthquake, of course, the other earthquake, the one in Iran and Turkey a few years back.
And I think we realized that there's always been earthquakes, but if we turn to Luke 21, uh-huh. Jesus said, the signs of the end, he said, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be great earthquakes in various places, and famines and pestilences, and there will be fearful sights and great signs from heaven. Mm-hmm. And then we move on to
25.
Verse 25, and we see, and there will be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and on the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Mm.
Verse 26.
Men's hearts failing them from fear and the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of the earth, the heavens will be shaken.
Mm. So, Matthew 24 and Luke 21, these two big chapters are dealing with the area of the last days, and of course the book of Revelation. And it's pretty plain when you see all these things happening.
Yeah.
And I personally think that that before the Lord Jesus comes, there's going to be a great revival, because millions are not saved.
Yes.
So there's got to be a great big harvest before we, leave this planet.
Yeah, I want to see a great big harvest, because there is a time coming, which we call the Great Tribulation, which is going to be such a terrible time that none of us want to go through that. Mm. So
Jesus said that, you know, a farmer can discern the sky, and he can know the weather for the next day, and he said you can discern. So when you see these signs, we should be able to discern where we're living. You know, there are people, many believers who live, who have no idea of the time and season that we're living in.
That's right.
We are living in the last days. Yes.
Yes.
You know, even in the days of the Apostle Peter, you know, people were saying, yes, you know, where is the coming of the Lord, you know?
Yes.
And it's been 2,000 years, you know.
I think the biggest sign most prophecy teachers would agree, and we're not going to go in deep today because we're not prophecy teachers, but the biggest sign really is the rebirth of the nation of
Israel. The rebirth of Israel.
Yes.
And of course, what we've seen is that there are many people who don't believe in Israel, people who don't believe in the importance of Israel,
and yes, a lot.
You know, they don't like the Jewish people, and you know,
yes,
and all that.
Yeah.
But why was the rebirth of Israel so important? And I think one of the reasons is because Jesus is coming to Jerusalem.
He's coming back
to the Mount of Olives. He's not coming to New York or London.
No.
You know, he is coming to Jerusalem. The Jewish people are God's people. In Romans 11 it says, you know, that God has not forgotten his people.
Mm-mm.
You know, and I don't know about you, but I love the Jews. I mean, you know, it's not about politics. It's about the fact that they are God's people who gave us the Bible.
That's right.
You know, and Jesus was a Jew. The apostles were Jewish, you know. This is a Jewish gospel.
Of course, we're not saying present day Israel is perfect in all its ways and doings.
No, it's secular.
God loves the Palestinian people as he loves all people.
You know what is beautiful is to see, there was a testimony of a Palestinian terrorist who was going to plant a bomb, and God spoke to him, and he got saved. Mm. So it's a long story. Mm. But he loves Israel. And he understands from the biblical perspective.
Yes.
You know, and it was so lovely to see him and a messianic Jewish believer.
Yes.
Praying together and worshiping, you know, because the real peace, as we know, is when Jesus comes, the Prince of Peace.
Mm.
Because no amount of politics and dividing of lands is going to solve this problem. This problem is not going to go away.
Oh, no.
In fact, this is a big stumbling block.
That's prophesied. The Bible says Jerusalem should be a stumbling stone.
You know, and so God loves everybody. You know, Jesus died for the whole world.
Yes.
You know, but we must not forget that the regathering of the Jews from the four corners of the world is prophetic.
Very. Yes.
The rebirth of Israel is prophetic. These are mighty big signs.
Yes.
And we should be aware that Jesus is coming. Now, it's hard, of course, to grasp the idea of the Lord Jesus coming and with his mighty army and Antichrist and all that 666 and, you know, a lot there. You know, you can find on Christian televisions that a lot of good speakers will go in depth. You know, so we're just skimming the surface.
That's right.
But I think the whole idea of this program is to get you ready for the coming of the Lord.
Yes.
And if you know that Jesus is coming,
how should you live?
Mm.
Yeah. Let's read verse 34.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus has just been talking about the signs of the end. Mm-hmm. He says, "But take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, and that day come upon you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch, therefore, and pray always, that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man."
I mean, you know, I personally believe that the way to live the cares of this life, you know, this, I don't think this is the time and season to be spending all your time and energy believing for a big house, a big car, or big this, or big that. I mean, yes, you know, we love the blessings of the Lord, you know, absolutely. But I'm not going to spend all my time you know, trying to get that big house when the house of God is not yet finished.
No.
You know, and millions are in the valley of decision.
Yes.
You know, so we should spend our energy and time building God's house.
Yeah, God's kingdom.
And reaching the lost.
Yes.
You know, and using our faith and energy and our time to build the local church, to help the pastor, to reach out, to be busy in the things of God. Because, you know, sooner or later we'll be standing before the Lord. And I thought, what an awesome moment.
Yeah. And we need to be awake to the signs of the times, awake to His coming.
You know, many, we go to many churches, but you know, we should be seeing people saved.
Mm.
We should be, you know, the work of the fivefold is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry.
Yes.
Every believer, without exception, should be praying for the nation, praying for the neighborhood, praying for souls to be saved, using their faith and energy. And going sometimes without, you know, suffering abuse, persecution, suffering ridicule. You know, the Jehovah's Witnesses, they always at my door, you know, and they without fail.
Yes.
And they work so hard, you know. And of course, we were going to work with the Spirit of God.
Amen.
You know, we can't do it in the flesh.
No, I'll tell you.
But it, this message should energize you.
Yeah. And there's a warning here as well. It says, carousing, which is like partying and drunkenness. We're, as children of God, we're not meant to be drunk like the world is. I mean, there's nothing wrong with, I don't think, an old...
Well, let's not go there.
Let's not go there, no. Okay, but we're not meant to be partying and drunken like the world. And otherwise, that day can come upon us unexpectedly, can't it?
So, you know, it's how much aware we are of the time and season. And of course, the other important thing is that when Jesus comes, now there's a teaching that we are going to be out of here, the rapture, and I believe that, you know, and of course there are people who believe that we're going to be here for the tribulation. What is most important is not to be around for the wrath of God, to be gone, because God's wrath is going to fall. Then there's going to be the Antichrist. There's going to be all hell breaking loose.
Yeah.
You know, there's a series called the Left Behind series.
Yes.
You know, and I would hate for anyone to be left behind. You know, the story of the 10 virgins.
Yes.
Five were taken, five were left behind.
Yeah.
And they, the five that were left behind had no oil in their lamp.
No.
Oil speaks of the Spirit. Oil speaks of, you know,
being prepared,
you know, being open, expectation, and to me, it seems to me that many believers will be left behind.
This is my personal opinion. I believe that backslidden believers will be left behind
because the trumpet will sound, and Jesus will call us up, and we'll be gone, and then the wrath of God, which is in the book of Revelation, will begin. You know, and I don't think we're far away. I feel such an energy to warn believers to do something for the Lord, to be busy.
Yeah.
You cannot be just going to church and warming the pew and the rest of the week you do nothing. You know, every Sunday you should be taking your neighbors and friends to the church, getting them saved, you know, doing follow-up. You know, looking after, you know, new believers.
I think when you realize that Jesus is coming, though, it does give you energy and it stops you looking inward at your own problems, doesn't it?
Yes, I mean, you know, everybody has problems, Sean.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, and you can be just so engrossed in your debts, in your mortgage, in your family, and the whole world is going to hell. And I don't think that we have much time. Now, I know people have said that. You know, I remember in the early 70s when we first heard this message, everybody decided, okay, you know, just sell everything and go up in the mountain and because Jesus is coming. And He didn't come, you know. And of course, the Jehovah's Witnesses always said different days. No one knows day and the hour.
Jesus said, occupy till I come.
No one knows.
The caves.
No one knows the day and the hour, isn't it?
That's right.
But we can sense
yeah.
the the season, the time of his coming. And these
there are
signs,
many other signs that we haven't even touched on today. Read Luke 21, Matthew 24, Mark 13. And, you know, listen to some of the programs that are available.
Romans 13 is a good scripture. Romans 13, 11 to 12. You want to read that, Sharon?
And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to wake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore let us cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light.
And I think it's once we are busy warning people, once we're busy telling others, I think faith would arise, and we then, our life begins to change as we become aware, you know, that one day, even if the Lord doesn't come in our lifetime, yet at the same time, we're going to stand before the Lord. And what would be a shame is to go to heaven empty-handed. Wouldn't that be a shame to you know the parable of the five talents? You know, Jesus commended the servant with the five talents and he multiplied. But the one with the one talent
and
buried
it. Yes.
And so whatever talent you might have, you know, you might be a musician, you might be an architect, it doesn't really matter.
Give it to the Lord.
And to use, to be aware, to be sober. The Bible says be sober, be watchful, to know what's going on. You know, and to look out for the signs. Not that we are constantly, you know, of course there are people who are constantly preoccupied with the second coming, you know, and always looking for reports. But, you know, things are happening. Right now, for example, we know that Iran is preparing a nuclear device. We know that that America will not strike. We know that Israel will have to strike because it cannot afford this threat. And so, you know, we're talking about a year, 2 years. Something is going to erupt. You know, and the other thing we also realize that all the nations are in debt. I mean, America is in debt by $13-14 trillion. You know, Greece, Italy, Spain, you know, all broke. Even this country is a trillion pounds in debt, this country. And I noticed there was this, the China and Russia talking about a new world currency called the Terra, and the one world government, the one world currency. One world currency means one world government, and the euro is going to fail. Of course, you know, I mean, no one knows. I mean, things might work out, but it's important to realize the season that we're living in and how we should live our life. Sharon, you said to live. You know, soberly.
Yes, watchful.
Watchful and and praying.
Yes.
And how?
Says, pray that you may be accounted worthy.
What does that mean?
Well, so that you can escape all the wrath that's to come. Yes.
The wrath is going to come, and but I have been so interested in this when I heard about the bees and how the bees are disappearing, and how. Can you imagine famine in the West? Now, like Russia has had the fires. Do you know that Moscow had a temperature of 39 degrees this summer? 39 degrees. It was hotter in Moscow than in the Middle East some days. Yeah. And the fires were burning the wheat. You know, and they had to cut the exports by 25%. Now, this is just a snippet of what could go wrong. Nobody can control the weather.
No.
You know, and... No.
Climate change, whether it's caused by cycles or global warming, whatever, I mean, it's going to make a difference to all the crops.
You know, so you might say, you know, you can scoff at this and say, well, you know, the Lord will be 100 years. Some people said, you should live as if the Lord is coming tomorrow, but plan as if he's coming in 100 years' time. So you don't, obviously, you don't stop planning. You don't stop planning your 5-year, 10-year program.
You don't stop going to school, you go to university,
and you know, it doesn't mean that somebody said to me, oh, if the Lord is coming so soon, I can just run up my credit cards and No. You can't, because the Lord may tarry. That's, you know, right. The Bible does say that the 10 virgins in the story,
yes,
the bride, while the bridegroom delayed.
Yes. I was interested in that.
Yeah. That it was because of the delay that the 5 ran out of oil.
Yeah.
You see?
Yes.
So if there's a delay and you lose hope, you lose your faith, you backslide.
Stay close to Jesus.
And I would encourage you to go to some of these channels where they teach about the second coming, and dig for yourself. The Lord is coming.
Yes.
The Lord is at hand.
Yes.
The Lord is coming. We have to be ready.
Yes.
We have to be prepared.
That's right.
And we have to be busy.
Mm.
You know, like the bee.
Mm-hmm.
Busy as bees, and like the ant. Look, you sluggard. You know the Bible says. And let's be busy for the Lord. Let's bless your pastor with taking 10 of your neighbors to church.
Yeah.
You know, give him a shock. You know, fill up the church with unsaved people. And, and the church will revive and warn people.
That's right.
You know, as I'm warning you today, you
know,
Jesus is coming.
Yeah, the Bible says, isn't it, in Thessalonians, that you're not in darkness so that this day should overtake you as a thief.
Mm.
You're all sons of light and sons of the day.
Okay.
And we should not sleep as do.
Anyhow, we come to the end, so
thanks
for watching. God bless you. See you again. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. At this moment, I just want to take some time to pray with you. Perhaps you're sick, perhaps you're ill. I see somebody, you're dying. I see one person dying at home, one person dying at the hospital. Perhaps you're watching this by television. In the hospital, somebody's brought you a tape. I just want to pray with you. I just want to bless you with healing. And also, I want to pray for those that are caught up in everyday affairs. Maybe you're so busy with family, busy with you can even be busy in church, but not really achieving very much. You might be busy with doing your house up and running around, and you really don't have much time for the Lord, and you're unaware that the Lord is coming. So I just want to pray with you that a wake-up call, that you would realize the season, the time that we're living in. And so I just want you to stretch your hands out towards the television as a point of contact. Let me just pray for you. Let me just pray for healing. Yes, there's a person who's watching, you're dying right now, and the healing power of Jesus Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit is coming to you right now. God is healing you. And as you make a dedication, say, Lord, if you heal me right now, I will serve you. I will work for you. If you pray that prayer, I believe God will raise you up from that deathbed right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever the pains and aches and pains you're suffering, the Lord's power is available right now to heal you. But most of all, I want to pray that your life would be energized, that you would suddenly have this wake-up call, that you'd be busy telling your friends, neighbors, telling your Christian friends about the coming of the Lord. So let me just pray for you. Father, I just pray for my dear friend who's watching in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, let the power of the Holy Spirit visit them. Let them be energized. Let them become active, reactivated in the things of your work, Lord. Be activated in the church, Lord, that they become a blessing in the church, that they be reaching out to the lost, and they be reading the Bible, Matthew 24, Luke 21, knowing that the time is short, living a life worthy of the Lord, not being preoccupied with big homes and big houses and all that materialism. Lord, I rebuke that spirit of materialism in their life, Father. I set them free to live simply, Lord, and to be moving ahead in the things of God. That they be rich, Father, in the things of God. They be rich in souls. They be rich in the work of God. Thank you, Father. I bless them, Father, with health and healing, energy. Yes, some if you're old, energy, strength is coming to you right now. Receive in Jesus, and be healed, be made whole. That's right, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. I have some wonderful material for you to have a look at, some wonderful books that has blessed me, and I think perhaps our viewers would like to get a copy. The first one is A Man Who Went to Hell, 23 Minutes in Hell by Bill Wise. A tremendous book that, boy, it makes your hair stand.
Yes.
And it's a good one to give to some of you unloved, not unloved, but unsaved friends. And the other book is 90 Minutes in Heaven by Don Piper, a Baptist pastor who died and went to heaven. Mm. So if you want to have a look at what heaven is like, this is a great book. Yeah. And a great book on healing that's just come out recently, Surprised by Healing by Dolores Winder.
Yes.
And an amazing story of healing. It really, really helped us to believe more when we read this book. And apart from the other books that we've already mentioned last month on the Holy Spirit that you can still get at our shop, these are some new books that are coming to our website. And this book is on prayer by Dr. Cho. We mentioned Dr. Cho earlier, the prayer that brings revival. And you can get this book. Everything that you want to know about prayer is in this book. And it's an old classic, 30 years old. And finally, this program, this broadcast, are available for you to purchase at a very nominal price. And so you can actually buy this program for yourself or for your friends, a DVD. And just contact us, go to the website, send us an email, phone us, whatever. And we'll be happy to serve you and get this material into your hands. You know, the books can never replace the Bible, obviously, but they do help bring understanding and
encourage
Rashan,
you
and encourage you. And these books are great books.
Yeah.
Books that we read ourselves.
That's right.
We wouldn't sell anything that we would not read for ourselves. So these are wonderful material.
Mm.
Plus, these broadcasts are available for you to purchase. So go back to our website. The information is on us on the screen.
Mm.
And prayer requests, we are available to pray for you. Give us a call.
Yeah.
And we look forward to being with you next time. And in the meantime, God bless you.